you can make those ends, your ends, reasonably and rationally. But those are objective standards of practical reasoning. And the question that we're worrying about now is, how do we know that they apply to us? And the answers that he's given here is that we know that they apply to creatures with a will, and we as a creatures that are free. And now the argument is that when we're deliberating, we are presupposing our own practical freedom, and therefore in deliberation, those objective standards we assume do apply to us, because we assume ourselves to be free. And that's it, right? So that's the argument. The argument is that in deliberation, we rationally recognize the categorical imperative to apply to us. What more could you want? Okay. So let me just mention the passage on 57 and 58, that this is true of any being to whom we ascribe practical reason. That is, to any being to whom we ascribe a will. Other people. And so we recognize the categorical imperative of climbing on anyone that we assume to have a will. This is what he's saying at the very bottom of 57-58. He says, "Now I assert that we must necessarily lend to every rational being that has a will also the idea of freedom under which alone it acts. For in such a being, we conceive a reason that is practical, that is, has causality with regard to its objects." So in other words, I've just been emphasizing the first person deliberative stance, that when I deliberate over what to do, I've presupposed that I have freedom, that I have autonomy, and therefore the argument is I'm bound by the categorical imperative. Kant's now saying this is true of anyone to whom we attribute a free will. So the next question then is, what can Kant say to this question? Why be moral? So he's saying this at the bottom of 58. This is the section is called "Of the Interest That Attaches to the Ideas of Morality." He says, "But why then ought I subject myself to this principle, categorical, and do so as a rational being as such, and hence thereby also to other beings endowed with reason? I'm willing to concede," he says, "that no interest impels me to do this." There's no external force that is making me do this, that there's no end that I'm trying to achieve that can only be accomplished by doing this. "For that would yield no categorical imperative. But I must still necessarily take an interest in it and see how this can be." Okay, so the answer can't be found in some external incentive. That wouldn't generate a categorical imperative, that would generate a hypothetical imperative at best. "For this ought," he says, "this ought that morality holds against me is actually," he says, "a willing that holds for every rational being on the condition. If reason were practical in it without hindrance, but for beings who, like us, are also affected by sensibility as incentives of a different kind, and whose case what reason all by itself would do is not always done, that necessity of action is only called an ought, and subjective necessity is distinguished from objective." so all Kant is pointing out here is that there's a contrast between ideally rational agents and agents like us. And this contrast is what makes the idea of a universal law of willing into an imperative for us, because we sometimes will diverge from that ideal of practical rationality, because we are tempted by possibly competing motives, possibly competing incentives. So Kant's point is that if we're asking what impels me to take an interest in the categorical imperative, what external interest is served by my being rational, what external goal is accomplished by my acting according to practical reason, the answer is none. The categorical imperative really is categorical defense. And if morality were about bringing some further end into existence, it would be hypothetical. It would say, do this in order to accomplish that. So I think this is a little clearer maybe if we think again about the formula of humanity. So you have to take seriously the idea that you should treat humanity as an end in itself, not as means to some further goal. If you treated people as means to accomplish some further goal, that would precisely not be treating humanity as an end in itself. That would be using people to accomplish some further goal, like, for example, increasing happiness, as in utilitarianism. So there can be no vindication of the categorical imperative. There can be no vindication of morality in terms of its promoting or its usefulness to some external goal. In particular, there can be no vindication of the categorical nature of morality in terms of promoting happiness, for example. So if the justification for morality, so if you're asking why be moral, and that is presupposing that the justification of morality is to be found in promoting some good external end, Kant would say no. Kant would say there's not going to be any kind of defense possible. But again, I want to come back to a point that I stressed. Don't confuse this point that morality as such has no external goal. Don't confuse that point with a different point, which is that when we act morally, we do have a goal. Whenever we act, therefore, whenever we act morally, we have some goal. There's some point, there's some end that we are willing whenever we act, whenever we will, and therefore whenever we act or will morally. So the point is that the supreme principle of morality, the categorical imperative, is not justified by its promotion of some external goal. But of course, whenever we act, we have some goal or other. And the question is whether in that action, our maxim satisfies the categorical imperative. So there's a confusion of levels here that sometimes occurs. Any individual moral action has some goal that's taken to be good. The point is that there's no single goal toward which all moral actions aim. Each moral action aims at some goal or other, but there's not some single goal that all aim at. So I want you to think again about the analogy I gave between the categorical imperative and the principle of non-contradiction. So the categorical imperative is supposed to be a standard of practical reason. And the principle of non-contradiction is supposed to be a standard of theoretical reason. It says that we ought not to hold beliefs that are contradictory to one another. And what I said was that the idea of the principle of non-contradiction is a standard that's implicit in the very idea of having a rational belief, implicit in the very idea of believing something for good reasons. So it's not any kind of external, the principle of non-contradiction, it's not any kind of external imposition on us. And it's not something that we have to accept in order to accomplish some external goal, in order to accomplish some further end. It's not like bad things will happen to you if you have beliefs that contradict that belief. I mean, maybe they will, but that's not why there's a problem. And exactly the same thing, exactly analogous point holds for the categorical imperative. The categorical imperative is vindicated as it were, an internal standard of practical reason. It's implicit within the idea of rational willing. It's not something that's imposed on us from the outside, and it's not something that's useful in order to accomplish some further end. Rather, it is found within the idea of rationally willing itself. Okay, sorry. So we'll stop here. On Wednesday, we'll start talking about the metaphysics of morals. I'll see whether I have one or two more words to say here about part three to wrap it up. I'm not sure. But you should read the introduction to the Doctrine of Right, for example.